Our gospel today is perhaps at first glance not that easy to follow. Someone slaps you on the right cheek, you give the left cheek. I guess in school, if one classmate kicks you, the tendency, of course, is to kick them back. But we see that our Lord Jesus, when he was here on earth, walked in the image of the Father. Like Father, like Son. When Philip asked Jesus, "Jesus, show us the Father," and he said, "Philip, I've been with you for so long, and you still don't know me. He who has seen me has seen the Father." You know, our children, sometimes they like it when people say, "Oh, you look like your father." But some don't like that. I remember when Kaina's boyfriend said to her, "You know, I thought you looked like your mother. But as I look closer to your face, I see your father. Joshua looks more like your mom, but you look more like your dad." And she didn't like that. But after a while, she accepted that she had a round face like me. Some kids, their goal is to be like their parents. Some, they don't want to be like their parents. But as Christians, the goal of every Christian should be to walk in the image and likeness of Christ. But that is not really that easy. Because when Jesus hung on the cross, after people spat at him, they put a crown of thorns on his head, they nailed him to the cross, he didn't say, "Father, upahan mo naman itong mga to." But he said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." God is love. But perhaps one of the hardest things to ever learn in this life is to love, especially our enemies. It says, "You heard it was said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you not to resist an evil person. Whoever slaps you on the right cheek, give to him the other also. If someone wants to sue you," you know, now we live in a day and age, even in the Philippines, "I'll sue you. If anyone wants to sue you and take your tunic, let them have your cloak also. Whoever compels you to go 1 mile," during that time, the Roman soldiers could compel someone to carry something like what they did to Simon. They said, "Simon, you help this man carry the cross. Whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to him who asks you, and from him who wants to borrow from you, don't turn it away. You heard it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. Pray for those who spitefully use you." You mean even our madams who spitefully use us sometimes, our employers, our boss, who spitefully uses us. And it says that you may be sons and daughters of your Father in heaven. For he makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good. Now God doesn't choose and say, "Okay, son, just shine on Malu because she's good. Ah, Imelda was bad today, don't shine on her." Now when the sun comes, it shines on everyone. He sends rain on the just and on the unjust. "For if you love only those who love you, what difference are you from the unbelievers, from the sinners out there? You are to be perfect just as your heavenly Father is perfect." None of us are perfect, but that is our goal. Like father, like child. When God created man in Genesis 1, verse 26, God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Notice, plural. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Male and female, he created them. So it's not like, oh, well, God created man in his image. No, man, male and female, he created them. We are to love other people, our neighbor, as ourselves. Notice, the term there is not you are to love your neighbor as you love yourself. That's not what it said. And the early church fathers are very clear about this. They said, Jesus didn't say you are to love your neighbor as you love yourself. You're adding already some words there. Jesus said, you are to love your neighbor as yourself, which is ontological, meaning according to the way God has created you. God created you in his image and likeness. You are to love according to your being because your father is love. Now, if your father, God, is love, then you are to love. That is what God created you for. So you are to love your neighbor as yourself. Unlike the second reading today, it gives a little bit more clarity to our purpose in life. In 1 Corinthians 3, verse 11, it says, for no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. In Ephesians 2, verse 19, it says, therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens of the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. What is a cornerstone? I used to think that cornerstone was a pillar or perhaps the foundation. No, the cornerstone is the first stone in the building which is put at the corner. Okay? It's the first brick there that's put at the corner. And it determines the direction of where the building will be, here in this corner and here. And every stone will pattern itself according to that stone. So if Jesus is the cornerstone, we are to follow his example. Which means you are to pray for your enemy. You are to say also, Father, forgive this person. Help me, O Lord, to love this person. When your enemy is hungry, feed him. When he's thirsty, give him a drink. Not that easy, but if Jesus himself is the cornerstone, then we are to follow his ways. In our song reading today, it says, teach me, O Lord, your way. Give me understanding that I may keep your law and observe it with all my heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments. In our collect today, if you notice, the collect is a very beautiful collect, but it shows us already what the message that God has for us is today. It says, O Lord, you have taught us that without love, whatever we do is worth nothing. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts your greatest gift, which is love. The true bond of peace and of all virtue, without which whoever lives is accounted dead before you. So if a person is alive, but cannot love, then that person is practically dead. Whoa. How can we love our enemies? Is it possible? You see, it is only possible when you have the Holy Spirit in you. Because the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit is love. God prophesied in Ezekiel 36, verse 26, I will give you a new heart and put my spirit in you. I will remove from your heart of stone, and give you a heart of flesh. You know, when a person cannot love their enemy or seeks revenge, it is because their hearts are hardened. Okay. What does it mean? It means our hearts need to be softened. Because our hearts can be so hard, filled with anger and bitterness. Unfortunately, we live in a time and age, and even in the Philippines, wherein we exalt revenge. We say, well, yes. Okay. When someone manages to take revenge, yes. He is like a tiger. Parang siyang tigre. Or he is like a lion. Parang siyang leon. Or like a snake. You know, when you touch the tail of a snake, the snake doesn't run away. pull the tail of a snake will come back and go. It will immediately retaliate and revenge, and we say, parasham, ahas. But when we say, this person is like Jesus, martyr. And so we put down a person who doesn't retaliate and doesn't take revenge. But the truth is, let me ask you a question. When do you manifest, or when do you show that you're a son and a daughter of God? How will you know that this person has a personal relationship with Jesus, or this person is a son of God? I guess one very good example is Saint Stephen. When Paul was looking after the clothes of those who were stoning him to death, he said, Father, please don't take this sin against them. And then he gave up his spirit. You look at Stephen and you can say, whoa, that's the very same thing that Jesus said. This guy is really a Christian. And it's when we begin to manifest the love of God for our enemies. It's not when you love only those who love you. Jesus said, if you love only those who love you, and you're good from those who you expect something in return, you are no different from the politicians, from the tax collectors, from those in government service who will build roads and build bridges because they want your votes. They want something back in return. But they will know that you are Christians and you are a son and a daughter of God if you are able to love those who are evil against you, those who hurt you, those who spitefully use you. It's easier said than done. Because sometimes we struggle, especially when people do something evil to us. The immediate reaction is, kailangan ko makabawi. I wish, O Lord God, you would call down fire and rain and just demolish this person. Like John and James, when they were passing through Samaria and they wouldn't allow Jesus and his apostles to pass through, they said, Lord, are we going to call down fire from heaven? Destroy all of these? said, you don't know what spirit you are of. We have to renew our minds. And the question is, how will you know, or how can you see that you are a daughter of God and a son of God? When someone is gossiping against you, you gossip against them in return. When someone steals or cheats you, you retaliate by cheating and stealing from them as well. When you were young, what did you used to do? When someone would steal one of your things or your favorite pencil or your favorite eraser, what did you used to do? You go and say, nanahawin ko rin yung kanyang yung pencil box na, nanahawin ko. Right? Do we do that? Right? Do you do that? Do you retaliate? Do you take revenge? At the end of the day, they will know that we are Christians by our love. As God our Father is love, ontologically, we are to follow Him in His example. Christ's goal was to be the image of the Father to us. And our goal is to be the image of Christ to others. Not just our friends, but you see, if you love your friends, it's okay because you're supposed to love your enemies as your friends as yourself, or your neighbors as yourself. But people will not see the difference between you and a non-Christian. Because a non-Christian, an unbeliever, also loves those who love them. But they will only see the difference when you are maltreated and injustice is being done to you, and you still love and pray for that person. That's when they will see the difference. People will not notice the difference if you just love those who love you. Notice the way that God has created us. When we love, there's peace in our heart. But when we're angry and bitter and have unforgiveness and want revenge, do you feel light in your heart? Or do you feel heavy in your heart? It takes more muscles for us to frown than to smile. Can't you see that God created us to love? The fruit of the Spirit is love. I was doing some research on what game the children can do because they're studying the same thing as you are studying. So I do research and I try to look for some games for children to try to get the message across. I was doing some reading and I found this. It's a bubblegum game and it's called Hard Heart, Soft Heart. And it teaches the instruction is for the catechist to buy bubble gum. So I told Matthew, I said, Matthew, go and buy bubble gum, right, in the shop. Yeah. And it says there you freeze the bubble gum for more than 24 hours. So it becomes solid and rock hard. And then you give it to the children. And you say, the first one to make the bubble wins. Of course they can do it, yeah? And then they have to wait for the bubble gum to melt in their mouth before they can chew it, right? So the name of the game is Hard Heart, Soft Heart. And the bubble is love. The only way that you can love your enemy is you have a soft heart. Start praying for your enemy. I tell you, start praying for your enemy every day. Every day, pray for them. Love your enemy. And little by little, you know what's going to happen? It's your heart that will soften. And then you will be able to love your enemy. Ezekiel, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. So, parents, if your children come up later and they have bubble gum, they're blowing bubbles, don't be surprised. Don't they say, oh, Mimi is kumakain ng bubble gum. No, okay? There's a lesson behind it that they're trying to teach something. You see, as human beings, we have that natural tendency when we're angry, we want to lash out on someone. Remember, when Cain was jealous of Abel, God went to Cain and said, Cain, why are you angry? Sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it. You know what? Cain hardened his heart. And there are many times in scripture, like the children of Israel in Meribah, it says there, when you hear God's voice, do not harden your heart. And they rebelled against God. Cain hardened his heart and he killed his brother. Don't let your heart be hardened. As soon as anger begins to come in your heart, pull it out. Pull it out. Like we studied that last week, that anger is the beginning of murder. It's all right to be angry at what the person has done or what the person is doing, but not at the person. You hate the sin, but love the sinner. Today, when you hear God's voice, do not harden your heart. And I tell you, as soon as you let the Holy Spirit come in and soften your heart, you will be able to love even the unlovable, even those who are difficult to love. Amen. Please stand with me.